In the next couple of lectures, we're going to study the file system part of the operating system. In this lecture, we're going to study what are files and directories and what are the operations that are available on them. And in the next lecture, we're going to understand how these operations are implemented by the file system in the operating system. So what is a file? I'm sure everybody is familiar with the notion of a file. A file is simply an array of bytes that is stored persistently on a disk or some such persistent medium, right? And a file is identified with a file name. Every file has a file name that the user gives to a file. This is a human readable name with, you know, some name and an extension specifying the type of the file it is. And every file also under the hood has an OS level identifier, right? A unique number given to a file by the operating system, and that is called the inode number. So you'll understand what this term means a little bit later, but every file has a file name and an inode number, a unique ID given by the operating system. And this inode number is unique within a file system, right? So this is the concept of a file. And what is a directory? A directory is simply a bag that holds a bunch of files and a bunch of other subdirectories, which might in turn have some files and so on, right? So a directory is like a container of files and other directories. And a directory is also stored like a file in most operating systems, right? A directory is simply a special type of a file whose contents are all the file names and their numbers. Right? You can think of a directory also as a special type of a file. Right? And files and directories in a Unix-like system are arranged in a tree starting with the root, and any file has a certain path name. For example, /bar/foo/bar.txt will lead you to this particular file. So in this path name, you have the root directory, you have the bar directory, you have the foo directory, and finally you have this file here at the leaf, right? So this is a path, and these are all the parent directories along the path to this file. So what are all the operations you can do on a file? Of course, there's the operation of creating a file, right? You create a file for the first time. So this is done using the open system call, right? This open system call, you give it a flag to create, and you give it a file name and a few other options, and it creates a file foo for you in the directory that you are in right now. And the open system call returns a file descriptor. So what is a file descriptor? A file descriptor is simply a handle using which, it is simply a number, it's an integer, right? Like 4, 5, 6. And using this number, you can always access this file in the future, right? It is a handle. And even if the file already exists on the disk, before you can read or write from it, before you can use a file in your program, you must always open a file, even if it already exists, right? That is also done using the open system call, right? So the open system call does, it can open an existing file or it can also create a new file. But before you can do anything with the file, you must open it and you must get the file descriptor, because all future operations on the file, you must quote this file descriptor as a reference, right? And finally, like opening, you can also close a file using the close system call. What are the other operations on a file? You can, of course, read and write from a file, right? So if this is a file and you have opened a file, you've gotten a file descriptor, you call read on the file descriptor, and the first read will give you a certain set of bytes. Then the next time you call read, it will give you the next set of bytes. The next time you call read, it will give you the next set of bytes, right? So you can read the read, you can use the read and write system calls to read sequentially from a file. So what are the arguments that these system calls take? They take a file descriptor. For the read system call, you can provide a buffer that has where the data should be stored. For the write system call, you can provide a buffer that has the data to be written. And finally, the read system call, you can give the size of the buffer. In the write system call also, you can give the size of the buffer. And in the read system call, returns the size of the buffer of how many bytes have been read, right? So there's the file descriptor, there's the buffer to into which you must read or write, and there's the size argument of how many bytes have been read or how many bytes must be written, right? So you must always open a file, get the file descriptor, and then call read or write on a file. And also note that by default, this happens sequentially. So when you call read and say, get me 100 bytes, the next time you call read, you can say, get me the next 100 bytes. The next time you call read, get me the next 100 bytes, right? So it happens sequentially. But what if I want to skip some bytes and I want to jump to somewhere in the file, right? So my current offset, that's called the offset, where you're in the file is here, but I want to jump to somewhere else in the file, right? If you want to do this jump, then you use a seek system call. The lseek system call lets you basically jump to a random point in the file and start reading or writing from there, right? There's also another system call called the fsync. So when you write to a file, some of these writes are still in memory. They're not guaranteed to go to the disk. So when you use the fsync system call, all the writes that you've made will finally be permanently stored on disk. And there are also other operations like renaming a file, deleting a file, and so on. You can also get statistics of a file, the size and permissions and so on, right? So all of these file system related system calls are available to be used in user programs. Similarly, there are also a whole bunch of system calls for directories. You can create a directory, you can open a directory, you can read a directory, and so on, right? For example, here is code for a simple ls-like program, right? So by the way, all of these commands like ls are simply programs, right? C programs that have been compiled into executables. And inside these programs, they use these system calls to access all the set of files and display them. For example, here is the ls, a program like ls. It opens a directory and it reads every entry of the directory, right? So there's a structure called the directory entry. This basically has the file name, the inode number, and so on. So you call read directory multiple times and you read every entry of the directory. You can read the file name, you can read the inode number, and so on, and the ls program simply prints it out, right? These are the directory related system calls that are available. Note that a directory is also treated like a file, just that it has all of these records of the file name, inode number, and so on. So these are the operations on files and directories. And there's also this concept of linking multiple files. For example, if you have a file with the name file, which has the contents hello, as you can see, you can cat this file and see hello. Then when you link, when you use this ln command to link file to file 2, what happens? This file 2 is also created with this name to point to the same underlying inode number, same underlying identity, to the same underlying file in the file system, right? So here is a file that has hello, and this file can be referred with the name file or with the name file 2. Both these names point to the same underlying entity in the file system, right? If you do ls, you can see ls minus I displays the inode number. You can see both file and file 2 both have the same inode number here, right? Because the underlying identity is the same, the contents, whether you read from file or file 2, are the same, right? And what happens when you remove the first file? You can still access the contents of the file from file 2, right? So here is the underlying inode. If the pointer from file is deleted, the pointer from file 2 is still there. Even if this is gone, you can still access the file from the other pointer, right? So a hard link, this is called hard linking file. A hard link is simply a pointer from a file name to an inode, right? And an inode maintains a link count of how many file names are referencing to me. And once all of those references are gone, so if here is an inode and this pointer is gone and that pointer is gone, at that point, this inode can also be deleted by the system, right? So this is the concept of hard linking files, which is why when you want to delete a file, right? So here is a file in some directory and there's, you know, a file name pointing to it. If you want to delete a file, all you have to do is you simply have to unlink. You have to remove this pointer from the directory to this inode. And once the pointer is done, this file is automatically deleted because no further links to it exist. Right? This is the concept of hard linking a file. A hard link adds a pointer from a file name to an inode number. There's also another kind of links which are called soft links or symbolic links, right? A soft link or a symbolic link is simply a link between two file names, right? When I do ln minus s file file 2, this simply establishes an alias, another name for file, which is file 2. So you can read the contents either by reading file or by reading file 2. But here, what is the crucial difference? If I delete file, then file 2 is also not accessible, right? If I delete file, so here is a pointer from file to some contents, and if I delete this link, if I remove file, then this thing is also gone. When I try to read file 2, I get an error, right? So file 2 is nothing but an alias for file, but it is not a separate hard link to the underlying inode, right? A soft link simply stores a mapping between two different names. That's all. So if you see the size of a soft link, also it is very small. It's just a few bytes to store the file name that it is aliasing. And there's this other concept of mounting a file system, right? So if your disk has a set of files, so here is a disk. It has a set of files in some file system, say ext3. When you mount it at a certain location, what happens? All the files are linked. So you have the directory tree, and when you mount a file system at some point, all the files in that file system are available starting at that point in the directory tree, right? You can mount a file system at a certain mount point in the directory tree. So when you mount the file system, you can access all the files in that file system from that point, from the mount point that you've mounted. And in a typical machine, multiple file systems, there are multiple disks, each of which are running different kinds of file systems, and they're all, for example, here is the mount output of the mount command. You can see there are many different types of file systems that are available on any given machine. And finally, the last concept we're going to see is the concept of memory mapping a file. So far, we've seen one way of reading and writing to a file, which is you open a file, you get a file descriptor, and you read and write from the file descriptor, right? Another way of reading or writing a file is memory mapping a file. So the mmap system call is a generic, is a very powerful system call. What it does is it creates a page in the virtual address space of a process. So here is the virtual address space of the process. There's the code, there is the heap, there is the stack, there are various other things. And when you call mmap, mmap gives you a page in this address space. It will give you a set of addresses to which you can read or write stuff, right? So there are two ways in which you can invoke mmap. You can either ask for an anonymous page, that is, you can ask for a generic page of memory in which you will store program data, or you can ask mmap to open a file for you. That is, what will that system call do? It will allocate a page in the virtual address space of a process, and the contents of this page will be something that is copied from the disk, contents of a file that is copied from a disk. That is, this page of memory is allocated in the virtual address space and it is initialized with contents of a file. Right, so such pages are called file backed pages, in contrast to anonymous pages. Right, so if you give a file name as an argument to mmap, it will allocate a page in the virtual address space and copy the file contents and return that page to you. So that when a file is memory mapped, now you can simply read or write from it like any other variable or any other piece of memory in your program. Right. You can treat it as a large byte array and you can simply read or write to it at any location, right? So memory mapping a file just makes it much more convenient to read or write a file. You can simply access the file as if it is a memory location in your program. So this is an alternative way of accessing a file. Of course, the standard way of opening a file and using read-write system calls with file descriptors can also work as well.